This is water. Sometimes it's cold and refreshing. Sometimes it's hot and soothing. Sometimes it's wild and it kills. Recall the black year of 1936 when the Connecticut River went on the greatest rampage in its history? Feeding on heavy ground covers of snow, swaked down with giant gulps of warm rain, it swaggered out of its banks. Slowly it crept inland, putting thousands of us underwater. People could get out of its path, but they couldn't stop it. In Hartford, where the Connecticut pushed back the Park River and overflowed to encircle the center, thousands of homeless were given food at emergency stores and fed at emergency soup kitchens. Goaded by this final affront, capping years of insult and hardship from the smaller floods, the government built a $20 million diking system in and around Hartford. It has kept the Connecticut in bounds ever since. 19 years later, in August of 1955, water made a new assault, a ferocious assault upon Connecticut. The fourth hurricane of the season formed in the Caribbean and moved up the North American shore. New Englanders relaxed when Diane lost her wind power midway up the coast. That was a mistake. Diane moved inland, then curved out through New England. She was mild in her movements, but her skirts were saturated with tropical rain. She wrung them out over Pennsylvania, New York, New England. Torrents of water fell. Rivers rose and rushed and leaped out of their banks. Connecticut's worst disaster was upon us. All over northern and western Connecticut, during the early hours of August 19th, persons wakened to danger and disaster, to destruction and to death. This was a different kind of flood from what Connecticut had experienced before. It was a flash flood. In rivers, in brooks, in creeks, water came up as you watched. Water raced in every gully. Water sluiced across every surface. Down from the dark hills it came, and down from the dark skies. Runs became brooks. Brooks became raging rivers. Rivers were transformed into tumultuous torrents. Watercourses turned into waterfalls. Water came from everywhere, and it sped everywhere, tearing out of channels, sweeping up dams, cutting through, carrying away homes and stores and factories, carrying away animals and humans. Torrents were upon persons before they scarce knew it. A giant had emptied a dishpan over the world. And when the dishpan was empty, the skies began to lighten and clear. Water still ran wild in the countryside and stood deep where it had trespassed. The WKNB news staff was at work through the night and through the day. This film was made by WKNB Television and Associated Photographers. Record of a disaster that took 70 to 80 lives and did damage of 200 millions. Incorporated in it are some scenes made available by the Army Signal Corps. Most of the film is devoted to Hartford County and parts of northern Connecticut. Many will recognize streets in their hometowns and in their own neighborhoods. Every branch of the military service lent its help, backing up the heroic work of the civilian officials and the civil defense workers. Rescue operations went on through the night and through the day. Boats operated where boats had never before been, saving persons, saving belongings. they made trip after trip, manned by tired but inspired ferrymen of salvation. In New Britain, as in other cities, firemen and policemen and civil defense workers and just plain citizens banded together. They stretched stout lines from beleaguered islands to the shores of the inland seas, guiding the young and the well, carrying the elderly and the ill to safety. Water pounded across lawns and fields far inland, where brooks had formerly been bashful and well-behaved. The Connecticut River at Charter Oak Bridge rose high, but controlled. Everywhere else, the water was unbridled, unsaddled, and unbroken. Where it didn't carry danger, it did bring inconvenience and hardship. Underpasses everywhere were flooded. Camp Current on Park Road in West Hartford usually lies beside placid Trout Brook. That dark day, it lay under the brook, water nearly to the roof of the pavilion. Trout Brook was angered throughout its length from Albany Avenue almost to New Britain. The whole world seemed angry that day, that muddy, wet, ferocious, cold 19th of August. That morning of the 19th, some persons tried to get to work or to go about their other business. Some made it, some stalled in asphalt-bottomed lakes. In some cases, they had no roads to drive upon. Route 44, the Hartford-Albany Turnpike, was one of the worst damaged. On the other side of Avon Mountain, on the village outskirts, travelers came to a halt, could go no further. Nobody dared to put a small boat across the broadened Farmington River there. Farm animals were rescued, and farm animals were stranded, left standing, wonderingly, on hillocks of safety amidst the encircling water. Took a special beating as the water swept over them and tunneled under. Some places the concrete held, other places it washed away or broke up as if it had been bombed. On the eastern slope of the mountain, the water bit out crevices that looked for all the world like the work of an earthquake. Rice Heights housing project on Flatbush Avenue in Hartford was hit, as it was again in the October floods. Families were evacuated twice through water that stood knee-deep and deeper still. Everywhere, persons stood about trying to think of some way they could help. Some of them just wondering where they could go. They had no home to go to. Flood is no respecter of persons. The Park River flows through fine neighborhoods as well as some less exclusive. The well-to-do were driven out with the poor, and whatever their circumstances, they pitched in to help others out. An oddity of the day was a truck with a tow line not from, but to a wrecker. The water was not dangerously deep at that immediate point, but the current was treacherously swift and undependable. Although the kids got a kick out of riding rowboats where roller skates can usually be used, the water missions were more serious to the adults. No buses drove through the underpass on Park Street, but boats negotiated the usually busy streets, and our cameras rode in the stern of a motorboat, passing familiar scenes as it putt-putted toward Hope Park. Everywhere the helicopters went to work on mercy missions, Army, Navy, National Guard, Marines, Air Force, all sent every available whirlybird. Governor Ribicoff, out to look at the destruction with his own eyes, had this to say to a WKNB-TV reporter.
It's been a great devastation to this beautiful state of ours. And there's been great loss in our state. And it's going to be a big, big job to clean it up and restore it to what it was before this tragedy hit us.
You're about to take off now for another...
Yes, we are. We're about to take off, not for a sightseeing trip, for a survey of the Putnam-Danielson area, and that will about complete the area involved.
And would you give us a statement for the people of Connecticut, Governor?
Well, the statement is there's a lot of work ahead of us, and I hope and plead with the people not to go on any sightseeing tours, stay out of the devastated area, because there's a lot of work to be done by the people who are interested in saving the lives and property in the damaged parts of our state.
Then the governor resumed his tour through the still gray Connecticut skies. Aided by his staff and the crew of the Flying Banana, he took off for a look at the terrible havoc in northeastern Connecticut. The helicopters are apparently ungainly craft, but they rescued dozens of persons who otherwise would certainly have perished. Shocking scenes passed beneath the governor's eyes. The water had desolated the countryside with impartial ruthlessness. Houses were mud-glutted, tipped on their sides, ripped apart. Timbers were splintered in the fist of the giant. Still bewildered, stunned, persons grubbed in the ruins for the oddments of their belongings, and were likely to come upon tokens of irony. Useless glass bottles standing undamaged amid the wreckage of what had been precious.